for you all to do. It shouldn't take you a second. Here we go. That was a joke, don't worry. How engaged would you say you felt with that slide? Please, either on the microphone. Good, Yvonne, that's nice and clear. Absolutely not. Please do feel free to put in the chat box your feelings about the slide I've just shown you. Yvonne has done a lovely TPR gesture, which suggests that the slide had the intended effect. So I'm going to be asking, overwhelmed, good, like, I'm glad. Okay. I felt a sense of dread. All right. Yeah, too much text, etc. Sense of dread. That's a good way of putting it. Please do feel free to use the chat box as much as you would like during this session. Or I may be asking some of you to come on the microphone as well. It depends on how you all behave. Okay. First of all, I just want to check something, actually, because I'm slightly worried about my internet connection, because it sort of goes on and off slightly. This is bad timing, but I'm going to switch networks. It will take me like 10 seconds to do, so hold on one sec. Okay, so I just want to check that you can, all hear and see me, okay? Yes? Yes, you can. Good. Wow, that worked. That's incredible. I had a new internet connection put in the other day, and whew, I'm so glad we have. Right, so okay, so here we go. What is non-learning? This is a big question. This is a big question. What is non-learning? I know, told you, Tanya, told you. Amazing timing. Sometimes. Right. This is non-learning. This is a concept of non-learning. Non-learning refers to situations in which somebody has the possibility to learn something, but the correct, expected, or intended learning does not take place. This is something that I was speaking to Zorica about a couple of months back now, and I find it a fascinating concept. Like I say, I absolutely sucked at maths when I was at school, and I was like the little kid in the picture here. There are three categories of non-learning. Here they are. There is, first of all, presumption with non-learning. What is that? It's, I already think I understand this, and therefore I don't see this as a learning opportunity. I want you to think, before I show you the next two, think of your students, think of any of your teacher students, your classes, and I would like you to think if you recognize any of these in-class situations. So that's presumption. Non-consideration. All this sounds terribly technical, but they will be very horribly familiar to you. I might see this as a new learning opportunity, but I don't relate to it. Maybe I'm nervous of it or what it might lead to. And last but not least, rejection. I don't want to learn something new in this way. So if you can think of any of your students who might have come under these three categories, feel free to share in the chat box. You can say yes, no, you can even put a name if you want to. Lots of high-level adults, Alex says, are fall under presumption. That is so, so true. And I have to say, at the secondary school I work at as well, it happens quite a lot. Well, back at International House as well. Teenagers, Natasha says, absolutely, because every year, as you know, we have to recycle the tenses they've already seen. So you do get a bit of, I'm not going to say it in Spanish, but they say no, but we saw this last year, teacher, why are we seeing it again? And then they complain to their parents. And then maybe the director talks to you about it and you think, you know why. Anyway, so I think part of this is to do with the whole one size fits all type of teaching, which does kind of happen a lot. And I'm not going to point fingers at why that happens now, but I do think you know what I mean. Doesn't happen all the time, but it certainly can happen. And it doesn't have to mean that, I think only if you are going to slavishly adhere to making sure that your students are in lockstep with the course book, for example, does it need to be like this. So I really don't think it needs to be like this at all. And there are many different ways of dealing with non-learning situations. In fact, I did threaten on Facebook the other day that I was going to quote the great Adrian Underhill, who is with us today. And we interviewed Adrian back, I think it was in June or July last year. And one of the wonderful things that Adrian said during that interview was the following. And Adrian, I have based this presentation around this quote. So please tell me you remember it. Adrian said, the student's job is to learn the language. Your job is to learn the students. I think this is one of the most helpful, I'm going to call them aphorisms, about teaching that I have heard recently. The student's job is to learn the language. Your job is to learn the students. I do think that things like classroom management in this way is something that is, let's say, overlooked quite a lot in terms of teacher training. So let's talk a little bit about this. We're going to start by talking about how important it is to empathize both with our students and getting students to empathize with each other. I'm going to give you a hypothetical scenario. This is Jamie. Now, Jamie is buying a TV. And when Jamie buys, oh, thank goodness, Adrian, that's great. If not, I was going to, I've put the interview link there just in case you didn't. So Jamie is buying a TV. What does Jamie do when Jamie buys a TV? Well, Jamie checks the website. Jamie lists pros and cons. Jamie does lots of research and asks friends. Jamie says, when Jamie's at the store, what do you think? Maybe Jamie says this to Jamie's friends as well. Where should I start? I was expecting something different. And there's a difference between what Jamie says and Jamie does and what Jamie thinks. And now I wonder if any of you have had this situation. Jamie thinks, do they think I'm stupid? What's best for me? Why is this so hard? And Jamie feels, well, what do you think Jamie feels? Jamie might feel overwhelmed, fear, anxious, and inadequate. All of these kind of things definitely happen, and they're things that we need to help our students empathize with. I'm going to give you another example. Who do you have on your screen in front of you now? Who is this? Well, I have some coffee, I just want a name. Surely you recognize this person. Hello, Glenn Standish. Taylor.
Taylor Swift. Yeah.
Good, Taylor Swift, lovely. All right, lovely, lovely. Yes, Taylor Swift. Yes, Alex, indeed. Now, Taylor Swift is famous for many things, one of which is writing breakup songs. And if you've never heard any Taylor Swift, you're about to get 30 seconds of Taylor Swift now. Here is what I would like you to do. It's totally up to you in which box you write. Let me just check that you can actually all write on the screen. Apparently you are all allowed to write on the screen. You have annotation rights. Actually, could you just put something on the screen? Like, you know, draw something, just like Alex is doing there. Fantastic. We will never, ever, ever. Exactly, Giovanni, you got it, you got it. Great, lovely. Love it. And it's a nice, smiley, happy face. This is beautiful. Okay, now, as much as it pains me, I'm gonna have to delete all of these now. No, I'm not gonna delete all of them. They're just too cute. This is what I'd like you to do. While you are looking at this clip, which just has the lyrics and the song, I would like you to write down, because this is in the category of what Taylor says, but I want you to think about what Taylor does and maybe actually how Taylor thinks and how Taylor feels, okay? So let me just check that I'm sharing my screen sound with you. Yes, I am. And here we go.
There's no time for tears, I'm just sitting here planning my revenge. There's nothing stopping me, I'm going out with all of your best friends. And if you come around saying sorry to me, my daddy's gonna show you how sorry you'll be. Cause I hate that stupid old pickup truck, you never let me drive. You're a redneck heartbreak who's really bad at lying. Watch me strike a match on all my wasted time. As far as I'm concerned, you're just another picture that burns.
Okay, so you get the idea. Thank you very much, Taylor. All right, so let's have a look at what we've got. So she burns stuff, goes out with friends. We know what she says. I already played that to you. We don't have so much about what she thinks, but we've got a lot of stuff about how she feels. Look at this, everybody. Vindictive, relieved, vengeful, annoyed. Very loud about how she feels. Okay, so I especially think, yeah, vindictive, relieved, annoyed, vengeful. All of these things. I hate to do this, but I've got to clear this. This is so wonderful. It's very important to get our students to think about and think how our students are feeling as well. I'm going to show you a few pictures here. What might they be saying? What might these people's lives be like? Do you recognize any of these? You really should. What might they be thinking? CAE, exactly, Tanya from Rome, exactly. What could be the significance of the mistake? How might they be feeling? All of what we have just done can really help our students who are perhaps going to do a modal-based international exam speaking, for example. I do recommend you have a go with it. Also really helps, especially the younger learners, empathize a little bit with each other and how they are behaving. Why is empathy so important in dealing with non-learning? Jarvis, who wrote the seminal text on non-learning, says that if the gulf between the learning situation and the learner's biography is too great, and if there is nobody there to help bridge that gap, then they may not consider the possibility of learning from the situation and may reject that group, and this can lead to potentially damaging situations for both parties. By the way, I will be sharing with you, and I already have at the beginning, but I will at the end, my contact details. So if you would like a copy of this presentation, that's absolutely perfect. It will be a pleasure to send it to you. So let's have a look at our three categories in turn. Presumption. I think I understand this, and therefore I don't see this as a new learning opportunity. Ways of dealing with this. This is an activity from the fantastic IHC, the International House World Younger Learners and Teenagers course. Question for you. In the 1940s, people had televisions. True or false, guys? Please write in the chat box, T or F. Bum, 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 bum. T says Glenn, F says Natasha, F, where? Around the world in general, let's just say. Very small number. Okay, so we're all divided on this one. The answer is F, it is false. It wasn't really until the early 50s people had TVs in their homes in the United States. What I would like you to do is think of a snippet from history, either true or false, from your country's history and write it in the chat box, like this one. Anything you can think of about your country at all. Actually, it could be about your country, can be about films, music, something like that. And again, it can be true or false, but I want you to write a sentence like this in the chat box. This one said in the 1940s, people had televisions. Anything you can think of at all, and it can be either true or false, anything you want. Like I say, either about where you are from, some random oddity about history, right? In the 80s, people had to queue up for washing machines. New Zealand was the first country to give women the vote. Good, things like this, keep them coming. There are mobile phones in the 1930s. All right, now, had we more time, what I would be getting you all to do is guess or think about whether these things are true or false. I see that you're doing that in the chat box already. Perfect, go ahead. Is that true, Natasha? Anyway, what language does this help the teacher diagnose? Apparently, yes. Wow. That is a fact and a half, that one. What language does this help the teacher diagnose? If I am your teacher and you are my students, well, you'll notice, okay, so good. You'll notice that everything that you've been writing has been in past tenses, and Glenn has written passive as well. Now, this is a nice little way of sneakily checking in a diagnostic way what your students are like with their past tenses. So instead of saying, okay, guys, today we're going to revise the past tenses, and they say, no, but we did this last year, you could try doing things in this way. We're going to do something related to vocabulary now. This is called coursebook Pictionary Revision. This is like Pictionary, but it's specifically related to whichever coursebook it is that you happen to be using. And I want you to look at the categories that you've got on the screen, on the right of the screen there. I'm going to draw a picture from one of these categories, and I would like you to tell me, first of all, which category it is and what it is that I am drawing. Now, I'm not very good at drawing at the best of times, it's got to be said. And as you can probably see now, I'm kind of sucking at this. It does look like a character from Ghostbusters, but it's not. Okay, the fact that I've got no guesses in the chat box already really makes me think. Okay, so yeah, all right, it's about technology, good. Yes, and specifically, what am I drawing? A computer. Yeah, sorry about that. So you can get your students to do this, and it'll get your teachers to get your students to do this in screens, in teams, And it gets extremely competitive, but it specifically relates to the vocabulary from the course book. Right, let's have a quick look at Mac Air. Yeah, you could tell that that was a Mac Air, couldn't you, Adrian? You could definitely tell that. Okay, let's now have a look at non-consideration. So this is a situation where I might see this as a new learning opportunity, but I don't relate to it. Maybe I'm nervous of what it might lead to. Let's have a look at this now. Grammar's easy to teach, just elicit everything, we've been told. Whoever said that has never seen Ferris Bueller's Day Off. How many times does this teacher say the word anyone? Please count and write the number in the chat box.
In 1930, the Republican-controlled House of Representatives, in an effort to alleviate the effects of the, anyone, the Great Depression, passed the, anyone, a tariff bill, the Hawley-Smoot Tariff Act, which anyone raised or lowered, raised tariffs in an effort to collect more revenue for the federal government. Did it work? Anyone know the effects?
Okay, so how many times did this not particularly engaging teacher say the word anyone? We've got sixes, we've got sevens. Most people have gone for seven. I think it is seven, actually. Yeah, no, it's a very funny movie, Olena. Absolutely. So there's, don't get me wrong, I know this isn't really eliciting. I'm just kind of kidding. But let's see if there's another way of doing things. Grammar lecture bingo I want to show you. Imagine you are my students and I just need to explain, because this is the way I've decided to do it, the present perfect versus past simple. This is a nice little activity to do with students. So what I would like you to do is tick, before I show them to you, is with the drawing tool, is tick off some of the words as I say them. So we use the present perfect when we are talking about experiences. These experiences, perhaps, well, they have happened in the past, and what we're doing, we're not talking about a specific time in the past, like last year or yesterday or last week. However, what we are saying is that those actions are relevant to now. They perhaps start in the past, they may be continuing today, and there's this idea that they are unfinished actions rather than finished actions. In fact, they might be ongoing. This is so much fun to just carry on like this, but I'm not going to. I just want to get everything filled up. So this is the idea. Sometimes teachers may feel they just have to lecture. They just have to explain something, and that's okay. This makes it a lot more involving and a lot more, let's say, learning going on. Okay, this is also to do with the concept of gamification, and Schatz tells us the following. One of the primary advantages of using gamification in an educational setting is that it lessens the cost of making an error in the eyes of the learners, thus prompting them to be more risk-taking. We know that as learners get older, they tend to be sort of less risk-taking learners, less tolerant of ambiguity. So this is how this is going to work. If your name, your first name, starts with a letter from A to M, you're in team one. If your first name starts with a letter from N to Z, you're in team two. Where you are, in the please put in the chat box one or two, depending on which team you are there for in. Now, this is very interesting because normally in South America, there's many, many more people in team one. And the reason I've been told for that is because often people's names begin with Maria something. Okay, so you know which team you are in, and this is how this is going to work, okay? I am going to one by one reveal a description of somebody who has either won the Nobel Peace Prize or who has worked for human rights. And what I would like you to do is write, as soon as you get it, in the chat box, the full name of the person or organization. We'll do the first one as an example. He was the leader of the American Civil Rights Movement. Name in the chat box, please. Right, so Glenn is the first out of the gate with that one. So that would be a point for Team A. I'm going to call you Team A and B, I've actually decided. Good, you got the idea. Now, I don't want Martin or Martin L. I want full names, okay? So if you have to write the name Aung San Suu Kyi, you have to write the name Aung San Suu Kyi. Sorry, that's just the way the game goes. Here we go, next one. She was an Indian pacifist. She worked with the poor and the sick. Bum, 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 bum. Who's going to be first? Glenn Standish, Mother Teresa. Very good. 1 point for Team A. Next one. It's a humanitarian organization and works to defend human rights around the world. A lot of volunteers and fundraisers make the work of this organization possible. Glenn, you were the first one to write the full name, which is what I asked for. Very good, Glenn. Team one, you are totally kicking ass right now. Pardon my language. Next one. She's an activist. She fights for the rights of indigenous people in Guatemala. Good, Anila. Fantastic. Team A, it's clearly your day. It's clearly your day. This is turning into a slaughter, team two. Right. Next one. He became the president of South Africa in the country's first democratic election. Alexander. Yes, that's another one for Team A. Team B, can we just get 1 point, seriously? Because otherwise this is... Actually, maybe it's better to get zero than one, because then it looks like you weren't trying or something, but let's see what happens. Well, you kind of know what the last one's going to be. It was Glenn. That's it. That's the full 5 points to Team A. Sorry, Team B. Keep playing. See you next time. I'm here till Thursday. All right, let's move on. The last one we have to look at today in the last 5 minutes. Oh, we've got 4 minutes. Rejection. I don't want to learn something new in this way. Why might this happen? For many reasons, we're going to look at a couple of solutions. Okay, what can you see in front of you on the screen? Yes, it's a display question. My question is clearly so daft that you've decided not to reply to me. Fair enough. So you've got a course book text here, and I'm not going to get you to read the entire text, but I'm going to show you an activity called buzzer text right now. Okay. And this is how it works. I'm going to show you a couple of paragraphs from the text. You have 30 seconds to memorize as much about this text as you can, because in a second, let me just hold on. In a second, in 30 of them, in fact, I'm going to remove the text. And what you're going to have to do, I'm going to read the text to you, and I will have changed 5 words. And whenever you hear a word that you think I have changed, I want you either on the microphone or in the box to kind of go bzzz, just like in a game show, okay? So there you go, 30 seconds. I'm going to try and keep quiet for 30 seconds while you memorize that, and I find my altered version on my cell phone. Me and technology, we've never been best buddies, it must be said. It's good for you, actually, because it'll take me a while to find this. All right, I found it now. Now you're all doomed. 10 seconds left. Okay, and that's it. Okay. So, like I was saying, I'm going to start reading. Any word you think has been changed, please go buzz either on the microphone or in the chat box. Are you sitting comfortably? Remember the artichoke and tomato pizza that you created? Okay, jolly good. What should that be? It should be anchovy. I heard some buzzing, by the way. Good buzz, whoever that was. Good. So, good start. For most of us, it takes a long time to learn how to make something delicious, but not for Remy Smith. Good. That should be what? Not delicious. Should be something else. So please, in the chat, good. Well done. All right. So, but not for Remy Smith. Still a child, she's already creating fantastic dishes. Good, Tanya. Good. Please go ahead and keep buzzing and sticking stuff in the chat box. Okay, good. She's also becoming well known for her French salad dressing, which is delicious. Good, buzzing. Your memory, quite impressive. It's probably because it's not like 20 past 7 in the morning where you're Italian. Excellent. And with her knowledge of social media, she's making sure that many people know she's there. Buzz, good, Giovanni. That's another buzz. And here is the correct version. The one I have changed. It was everyone rather than many people. Now, I've just really picked random vocabulary, but what would be a good idea is if you pick vocabulary or your teachers pick vocabulary that is related to a specific topic. I've just invented a word. Specific topic or lexical set. Okay. And this is another quick activity which I'm going to show you to deal with the same kind of issue called work out the word. You can imagine that probably if students have to study lists of vocabulary like this, they're not, you know, massively engaged by the idea and may be some serious non-learning moments that may happen. This is a really nice idea because I've played this with my students quite a lot and they've really enjoyed it because we're all online again here in Argentina with our teaching. You can see that you're able to send messages to people privately through Zoom. I would like somebody to send me a private message and just with the one of these words, one of these personality adjectives in the chat box. I will take whichever one first and I will describe it to you and the rest have to guess which it is. Glenn, thanks so much. You would pick the most difficult one, right? I am the kind of person who I'm just always in a bad mood, to be honest. And in fact, if somebody asks me, how are you today? Fine, why are you asking me? And if you offer me something like, would you like a cup of coffee? Just, why are you bothering me now? Thank goodness, Adrian, grouchy. you've spelt it like it's a Latin American Spanish expression. But yes, grouchy, very, very good. That's absolutely the right one. Giovanni, I'd love to know what it is. Very good. The last activity we are going to do today, I'm almost just going to be on time with this, is called pronunciation stepping stones. Here is how it works. But Adrian, I believe that you have seen this before, and please forgive me because this is to do with your topic. So I really hope I don't make any mistakes. Oh, you love it. Thank goodness for that. That is an endorsement. I've changed it slightly since you last saw it, but here it goes. Now listen, you were in two teams A and B before, but this time you are going to be in three teams. I would like you to choose one of these characters, either Dora the Explorer, Snoopy or Tintin. Please in the chat box write who you would like to be, who you would like your avatar to represent you. Okay, lots of Doras, precious few Tintins, lots of Snoopies. All right, here we go, this is how it works. Now, your avatar is stuck on one side of the river. You have to get to camp across a crocodile-infested river. In front of you, there are five stepping stones. Now, in order to get to your camp, you must cross these five stepping stones, and this is how you are going to do it. First of all, what I'd like you to tell me is, in front of your character, please write the name of the object. What is object in front of the name of your character? Okay, mill, bath, vase, etc. If you look above the character's heads for a second, vase begins with the consonant sound V, V. I've chosen consonant sounds which are typically, traditionally, difficult for learners in my context in River Plate Spanish to realize. V, above Snoopy said there is an I, a mill, and above Tintin's head and Snowy's head there is a th for bath. Sorry, a the for bath. Actually, I've got that wrong, haven't I, Adrian? I've just realized if it's bath, it should be th, not th. My goodness, that's a good start. Anyway, I would like you to go with the phoneme that is above Tintin's head, okay, which is th, not th. And here is how it's going to work. In order to get to camp, what you have to do is you've got now one, two, three, four, and five spaces to get to camp. You have to list five words which contain the phoneme of your chosen, that is above your chosen avatar's head. Now, no, wait a second, Vesna, wait a second. I want you all to promise faithfully. I would get you to put your cameras on and put your hands on your heart, but we really don't have time. So I would like you to promise that you are not going to put the words in the chat box until I say so, okay? Now, the best thing to do is probably list all the words and hit return when I tell you. So, oh, I can hear somebody in the background there. I don't know who that is. Okay, right. So here we go. Alejandra, can I just, there we go. I love being co-host sometimes. Right, here we go. Are you ready? Five, four, three, two, one, go. Wow, who is first? Jonathan, kill, will, dill, bill, till. Jonathan Pendlebury, you are first. Your character is saved, first of all. You are Snoopy. An excellent choice, by the way, Jonathan. Very good. So Snoopy gets across the stream first. And it looks to me as though little, who's next? Violet Avengers, Navajo, good, Giovanni. Giovanni may well be second because we've got lots with I in it. No one's decided to go for the th sound. Oh, Alex has gone for th, for Bath, Roth, Da. You had a difficult one, it has to be said. It has to be said. Very good. And this is how this works. And this is getting from the students whichever words that they can find, perhaps like in your own context, you can put in the chat box if there are any phonemes from the wonderful phonemic chart which your students find difficult to produce. Like I say, these three are pretty difficult in Argentina. B and V tend to be like almost exactly the same in Argentina. Good, fantastic. So last thing for you, I'm not going to get you to do this now. Try this with your students. This is about tailor-made teaching. So at the end of the class, ask them, in this class we looked at what, and get them in the chat box, you can get them to do this face-to-face, just spend 60 seconds writing what it was they saw in that class. Because I'm like 5 minutes over, I'm not going to get you to do this now. But that's the idea. They spend 1 minute just thinking about what they saw in the class. Everyone will have a different story, as it were. Everyone will have a different summary. And it's great, especially in Zoom, in the chat box, that they can all look at each summaries. Besides, they're only writing for 1 minute. So even if they're younger learners who traditionally don't really like writing so much, they won't have any issue with that. And it will come to them what the most salient points of the class were and turn possible non-learning into a little bit of learning. You guys are still playing the game. I love that about you. Okay, good. Like I say, I was going to give you my contact details. Here they are. You've got my email, you've got my Instagram, and you've got my Facebook page. Please feel free to get in touch, and I'm happy to send this to you. Zorica, sorry for going over. I apologize. No,
that's all right. My God. Lovely energy, 7 o'clock in the morning.
it's the Argentine coffee, Zorica. That's what it is.
It was really engaging. Thank you so much. And
you're
yes, we will share the recording, and also if you would like to send us your PowerPoint presentation,
sure,
we can share it. Yeah. So
we'll
that's